Hey DJ, just play that song, keep on scratching all night. Hey DJ, just play that song, you have me itching all night.
For the next 10 weeks, we will discuss a different element of hip-hop culture. Those elements being the DJ, the MC, breaking, graffiti art, street knowledge, beatboxing, street fashion, street language, and street entrepreneurialism. For the first time, we will bring experts to discuss and define each element of hip-hop culture. And so the difference between the brand and the line is all of those things in the recipe that you just mentioned.
Those things and more. I mean, you know, we all can have an item, but how many things are called brands? You know what I mean?
Right.
And then the further step after a brand is to become a lifestyle.
Right.
Which never changes.
Right. As a hip-hopper, what do you say to people that say hip-hop culture is a negative influence?
I think hip-hop culture is a reflection, first of all, of what is going on. It's the language of, you know, the people who don't have much. Mm-hmm. It's the communication. And it's the same way that jazz started, it's the same way that rock started, and you know, our parents and forefathers went through this stuff at that point of their life.
Mm-hmm.
I think that, first of all, it's the language. Second of all, certain corporations do thrive on the fact that, hey, you know what? We're going to thrive on this aspect of it and make a lot of money off of it and filter out all the other music because this is what is, you know, viable.
Right.
Now, if like any other consumer product, if you put out something and people don't like it, don't want it, and it doesn't work, then you would not be successful in doing that.
True.
So why does the music keep getting played? Because people are consuming it.
Right.
You know, and that's a bigger issue we have to look at.
Right, that is true. And I think, you know, it's kind of coming to a head now because, you know, you got Clear Channel in New York and Clear Channel all around the, you know, the country, and they're playing the same 13 songs and people are getting tired of it, you know?
Yeah, and when they get tired of it, and then it's cool. But you got somebody like a Kanye who's going to come out and, you know what? I'm into hip hop, but the only album I bought recently was Kanye.
Right.
You know, because like he said, and nothing against 50 or some of these other artists, is he talks about everyday issues, not killing. How many people you kill in a day?
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, definitely. Back to what we were talking about with the fashion. Are you formally trained? Did you go to college to learn all the marketing and all the other things that you talked about in the recipe for success? Or how did you learn this?
No, you know, I did not. I just finished high school, but a lot of it is just pure common sense.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of us are overeducated and overthinking common sense.
Right.
And I did learn a lot as, you know, as I progressed in the business and really studied and take notes. I mean, I do read a lot, so I'm educated in the sense of, you know, reading a lot of material.
Right.
And using some of the more historical ways of marketing and understanding brands and then changing around to today's environment. But, you know, I don't have any formal training in regards to college.
Okay. Now, we touched on this topic just a second ago, but where can being a street fashion designer take you as a career? Where can it go into? You said a few things, but I'm curious.
I mean, well, as a career, you can go anywhere in this world in regards to being, forget street fashion, any type of fashion.
Right.
Because you know what I have right now, you know, probably, you know, it could range from, you know, 20 different positions in my company. If you're a person and you're designing and you're doing technical designing, and that means basically, you know, the size of the buttons and the zippers and this and that, you can work everywhere from here to Chanel. You know, if you know how to, you know, fabric and stuff like that, there's no way you can stop. There's no place that will limit you in the fashion business. You know, so any place, you know, you can be anything from an art director to a technical designer to anything else.
Would you consider yourself more of a designer or an entrepreneur?
I'm an entrepreneur.
Okay.
And I'm a brand builder, basically.
Right. Let's talk about your book a little bit. Where can people get it? What's your book about? And what made you decide to do this?
Okay, well, you can get my book. I believe it's in Barnes & Noble's and all the other guys' Borders, but you could easily get it, obviously, on Amazon, sorry.
Okay.
For years, people wanted to know the FUBU story because there's not a lot of myths, misconceptions. Did we sell it? This and that. You know, a whole bunch of other stuff going on out there.
Mm-hmm.
They also wanted to know about, you know, what happened with FUBU. A lot of times they want to know, you know, who did we sleep with? How much money we spent? Blah, 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 blah. I didn't find that information needed out in the market. You know, you want to know about gossip and those type of things, you can just pick up any book, any magazine on a weekly basis. You know, so I decided, how am I going to put a book together that's going to teach people common sense and what they need to know about this business? The person I started putting together with, he said, listen, they need to know who you are, because nobody ever really knew you. They knew the FUBU guys, they knew you a little bit by face, but they did not know who you were. So wrap this around your life story.
Right.
So I put together my life story and showed you my thinking. I showed you why there was an opportune time for a FUBU at that time. I showed you all my failures, as many of my failures as I could put together, to show you that I was the same person going through the same crap that a lot of our readers and listeners are going through.
Right.
And then I started to show what and how you need to think to start any business. Forget fashion. Mm-hmm. Fashion just happens to be the product I'm putting out. But any type of business is still a product.
Yes.
So I started to put those things together in the book, and I compiled all the most commonly asked questions that I'm asked when I speak at any school, church, you know, entrepreneurial conference, whatever the case is. And I try to put all those answers in the book.
How did you overcome the struggle that many of us have of trying to put our financing in place? What was your plan for that?
My plan was like anybody else. I had no plan. You know, I wrote this little, request from the small, you know, to the small business, whatever, loans or whatever the case is. I got turned down for loans 27 times.
Wow.
And then I came up with a just crazy off-the-wall idea. I thought differently, and I came up with a way to go out there and raise money, and I put that in the book in detail.
Okay. I really appreciate your time. Thank you so much for coming by. Is there anything I know everything's in the book, but is there anything that's just off your head that you would tell people that want to be into the fashion industry now? What would you tell them real quick?
Well, I would tell anybody in any business, but even fashion, is to, before you go out and spend all your money and take loans from grandma and put your house all up and everything like that, I would say to start off small with a small line and grow it locally in your area. You know, local fashion shows, take it to a store and have them try to sell it, and, you know, they'll pay you once they sell the product. Find out if you're on to something. Because, you know, a lot of people have these one or two items. They'd be like, well, I'm going to change this world with this item.
Right.
To have a successful fashion company, you better have an item every 3 months.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? To
right.
keep you going.
Right. Keep it fresh.
Right. So once you find out that you're onto something and the prices are working and the style is working and people like your stuff and the quality is there, then you can slowly start expanding. And once you start expanding, then bigger guys start looking at you and you get distribution deals.
Gotcha.
And that's the same with records.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Same with anything else.
Right. Well, Daymond, thank you so much for coming by, and I really appreciate you taking the time out, and we'll look forward to talking with you soon, and good luck on all your endeavors.
All right. Thanks for having me, and listen, tell everybody they can hit me on displayofpower.com.
Okay.
As well as I'm a contributing editor to Hip Hop Weekly, so I give business advice every week in the Hip Hop Weekly.
Oh, cool.
All right.
Okay. Thank you so much, Daymond.
All right. Peace.
Okay. Peace.
This is Miles, and we're taking a break, and we'll be back with the King Tucker Show.
This is dedicated to the lover,
to the lover
in you, in you, in you.
Leather in the summer, silk in the winter. This is such an art, where do I begin? Used to sing tenor in the church choir. Really, I was flexing, but the girls, they were fine. I'm that type of guy that noticed subtle signs. When I cuddle mine, she ain't even trying.
Yo, this is Big Daddy Kane.
This is Dick Gregory.
This is Cheyenne Stallone.
This is Dr. Maxine Mim.
This is Elmer Dixon.
And yes, y'all, this is Melly Bell.
This is the Indigenous Fly Girl.
Yo, this is Johnny Houston.
Big M1, one half of Dad Fred.
This is Opio.
This is Paradise.
This is QD3.
This is your girl, Miss Tricky.
This is Tony Muhammad.
Yo, this is KRS-One, and you're checking out the Keith Tucker Show.
And bow down. And bow down.